Hello, and welcome to Answer Everywhere. Today we're taking a look at GTK, the GNOME toolkit. And we are in GitLab, and they don't even seem to have an official mirror in GitHub. But let's dive in. GTK, I'm going to guess, is pretty huge. So I'm not sure how much of it we're going to get to. I'm not sure even where the coolest stuff is. I guess let's just ask Gemini in the GTK codebase, where's the coolest stuff? And let's also ask ChatGPT, because ChatGPT, I think, sometimes has a better sense of coding than Gemini does. Although Gemini is rapidly improving. The widget toolkit implementation, CSS styling, accessibility features. That's not necessarily the coolest stuff. Those are all important. Yeah, so Cairo integration, a powerful 2D graphics library for rendering widgets, custom widgets, drag and drop and gestures, accessibility, cross-platform development. That's pretty similar. Okay, so who knows? I've got some build stuff. I saw before they have some sort of Maison-based build somewhere. A bunch of news. Tools, tool suite, subprojects, PO should be internationalization, modules, GDK, GSK, and GTK, some examples, and some demos, and some stuff. They've got a discussion forum on Discourse. And maybe since it's so big, we should define what it is that we want to see in looking at this repo. I guess if you're interested in doing a GTK app, there are probably simpler ways you can get started looking at GTK. So I guess maybe what I find most interesting is if you wanted to contribute to GTK or add GTK support for newer devices, or if you wanted to make your own toolkit, I think it would be nice to have a sense of really what's involved. Where is the complexity? Sometimes complexity is the details of implementing some logic are really hard. Sometimes the complexity is you just need to implement a sea of different compatibility files for all of the different devices. So just having a sense of that sort of thing. So I guess that's kind of where I'll try to go, or at least that'll be my initial mood as I'm looking through the code. So GTK modules doesn't have much. We've got a Maison build. We've got media and print backends. I don't know what that's about, but I'm just going to ignore it. GDK, I don't know what the D is for. Maybe developer? Let's look this up. GTK, GDK, and then there's GSK as well. GTK is divided into three parts. All right, so normally we don't read the documentation. But since I think that this is going to be gigantic, I am going to read. So where's this three-part stuff? Okay. So GDK with a D is the abstraction layer that allows GTK to support multiple windowing systems. GDK provides window system facilities on Wayland, X11, Microsoft Windows, and Apple macOS. GSK is an API for creating a scene graph from drawing operation, there should probably be an S here, called nodes, and rendering it using different backends. Okay, so this is some scene graph stuff. We've seen a bunch of scene graphs. If you've seen my stuff before, which if you haven't, you should. We've done a bunch of game system stuff. We've looked at Blender and Godot and Ogre 3D, which has some game engine-y stuff, and some more things along those lines. And so we have a sense of what scene graphs are about. And we've seen this pattern before of you want to build up some sort of tree out of scenes, and then you have some layer for kind of doing translations to the different hardware languages, like OpenGL, Vulkan, and Cairo. Then we have GTK, which this must be recursive. So the GUI toolkit containing UI elements, layout managers, data storage types for efficient use in GUI applications, and much more. So just by recursion, this GTK must also be composed of GDK and GSK. No, not really, but okay. And then we have this other overview. I don't know why, you know, what is the difference between this being divided into three parts and all of these other things? These seem like other parts. But let me scan this just to see if there's anything interesting to say. This, we've got bindings for different languages, et cetera, et cetera. We've got widgets. GTK depend, so these are dependencies. We depend on the following libraries. Glib is a general purpose utility library, not specific to graphical user interfaces. I think we've seen some of the glib stuff in other repos. So data types, macros, type conversions, string utilities, file utilities, a main loop abstraction, and so on. So, but I think this probably was, or at least this is also part of GNOME. So part of the same project in the larger sense, but not necessarily the toolkit. And then GObject is a type system. I don't know if you'd call it a type system, but it's maybe an implementation of specific types, a collection of fundamental types, including an object type, a signal system. So you've seen the signal system in Qt. Qt, for example, we saw it in OBS, made pretty heavy use of Qt signals and slots. More information is available on the GObject website. GIO, a modern, easy-to-use VFS, I'm guessing virtual file system API, including abstractions for files, drivers, volumes, stream IO, and blah, 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 networking. Then Cairo is a 2D graphics library. OpenGL is OpenGL, and Vulkan and Vulkan is a similar graphics API. Pango is a library for internationalized text handling. I guess that's what the PO stuff is. And GDK PixBuff, a small portable library which allows you to create GDK PixBuff pixel buffer objects from image data. Okay, so this is some like GNOME-friendly image data thing is how I'm going to think of it. And then Graphene is a small library which provides vector and matrix data types and operations. Okay, presumably for graphics, because a lot of the graphics stuff that we've seen implements their own vector and matrix data types and often quaternions. Okay, so that was useful. That kind of tells me a bunch of stuff I can ignore. Like I'll just ignore all the dependency stuff. And that leaves me the question of whether we want to focus on GDK, GSK, which is the 2D geometry stuff, and GTK, the widgets. I guess, is API same as header file in C? That's a good question. I don't know where we saw API here. Yeah, I would think so. The header file defines the like public API in C. And I don't know if that's the sense in which they're using it, but more or less like a group of header files rather than a single header file. Maybe this will not be the highest priority. GSK may not be the highest priority since we've seen a bunch of the 2D graphic stuff. GDK, I think, is going to be down in the weeds, and it's going to depend on a bunch of stuff that we haven't really seen. We have looked at X11, and so I think we are going to focus on GTK proper. So let's do that. Although, I kind of feel like maybe we should keep GDK and GSK open in the background as, you know, if we decide we may want to look at them later. But maybe I will minimize them. And then we have examples and demos. I don't know how a demo is different from an example. But we have things like print editor, node editor, widget factory, constraint editor, GTK demo. I guess, ignore all those. And a bunch of applications. Application 8, I guess. Example app.h. There's not much there. What about example app.c? Okay, whatever. We've seen a few GTK apps, so let's just plow along. Okay, so here we are in GTK main. A11Y will be accessibility. Compose, who knows? There might be text composition that might be somehow composing widgets together. CSS is probably going to be complicated and full of details, but it might be interesting. Emoji might be somewhat amusing. Icons, I guess I'll ignore. Inspector and print, I'll ignore. Roaring, it's probably not so interesting, but theme, I'm going to guess, is mainly done by CSS. TimSort, I think, is a well-known sort algorithm that like combines to a hybrid stable sorting algorithm derived from merge sort and insertion sort. The algorithm finds subsequences of data that are already ordered, which they call runs, and uses them to sort the remainder more efficiently. Okay. We don't need to look at TimSort. I think we've looked at TimSort before. UI is probably important. Function match might be some sort of dispatch thing. In fact, that might be worth looking at quickly if it's small. And what else? Greetings. No, sorry, not greetings. G settings. I feel like G settings is one of the worst parts of GNOME. No offense to GNOME. Okay, so here's the GTK header, which is probably vitally important. I'll do it after function match, just in case function match is small. An Excel group, I guess like an acceleration group. I don't know necessarily what those are about. We have accessibility. Accessibility is interesting. I don't think it's particularly well done on Linux, but maybe we'll take a quick look at what the accessibility header has to offer us. Accessible text, accessible value private, GTK actionable. Let's look at actionable and actionable.c. We have the action bar. I guess that's not so important. We've got a bunch of them. Are these all GTK something? Yeah, this is endless. I'm not even sure what we want to do. Maybe we'll look at event controller.h. Enums, I'm going to guess, is just really enums. Maybe sometimes it's useful to look at enums. Expression maybe is interesting. Seems like we don't get a C file. Sorry, don't get a header file. We just get a C file. Oh, no, we do. What am I talking about? A chooser cell. Let's look at the chooser dialog, I suppose, which will presumably have a chooser entry. This is just like super flat. I don't know if there's a benefit to this flatness. Context chooser. I mean, I guess the benefit is you don't have to remember what directory something is in when you're using it. Is that a huge benefit? I guess label is probably pretty fundamental, like a way of attaching, maybe just a way of attaching text to something. A list header, list item. Should we look at list item? Yeah, I guess so. Again, I'm not sure how many of these we're going to get to. Here's GTK main and GTK H. Let's kind of pop these over. No, it's not. And there's just everything. I guess there's no real purpose in opening all of this. I guess you have a KRB tree. No, sorry, an RB tree. So it's just a red black tree. But I guess let's just look at query and range. And I think I said at the beginning that like sometimes the complexity is just you have to implement a bunch of stuff, which is essentially how Metasploit works. The one we looked at just prior to this, you have to implement a bunch of scripts. And that's really the complexity of Metasploit. That's the hardest thing to replicate if you were going to rewrite something like Metasploit from scratch. And similarly for GTK, a lot of the work seems to be just be in implementing all of these widgets and making sure that you've covered the whole space of widgets in a way that like app developers feel like the thing that they need is always available. So there's just so much here. So yeah, I'm just going to open the ones that I've opened. And then if along the way we see ones that look especially fascinating, we can open those too. But I have a feeling that a lot of it's going to be a lot of the same over and over again. So here's function match. I don't know why I opened function match. Just something seems to draw me to it. But let's take a look. Is it big? Not big. A Gunicar. G is maybe G for GNOME. Unicar. Uni. Character. Some sort of const car star star string. And what some case fold, which is a Boolean. A G Boolean. And what is going on? So we're going to set C to G UTF-8 get car. So I'm going to guess get a UTF-8 character from the string. We're going to consume, a character. And then we're going to set the star string to the next car from the string. I guess setting the pointer to point to the next thing. And if case fold, I guess case fold is something you can, a toggle you have. If we're case folding, we're going to call to lower and return C. Why are we doing that? I don't know. Get unit. I don't know. I don't know how to think about. Okay. So get car is the function. I guess G unit car is the type. So I was just confused by this mad, syntax, formatting preference. It's just different than I'm used to. Okay, similarly, we've got get unescaped car. Function match intern. Match string against the file name pattern, P capital P pattern. Returning zero if it matches and non-zero if not. So, why? So we're going to give it a pattern and a string and some booleans. Like whether component start, no leading period, case fold. I don't know. We're just doing some matching. I guess this is not so fascinating. Match string against the file name pattern, returning zero. Okay. I'm not sure what function matches or FN matches. Maybe I was misinterpreting it as function and really means something else. Okay. So here's gtk.h. This is, I guess, the main GTK header. And I'm going to guess it's huge. Let's see how huge it is. Oh, no, we're at the bottom. Okay, so we're just doing includes, which makes sense. And we're including all of the things that we can, including a bunch of deprecated stuff, buttons of various types, etc. And then here we are in compose. And I wasn't sure what compose is about. GTK includes a copy of X11 compose file in a compact pre-compiled form. The same format is used by caching custom compose files in the home directory. The X11 compose file can be found here. Okay, so this is, I guess, vendoring something from X11. But why? I don't know. This program reads a compose file and generates files with sequences, character data, and definitions for the built-in compose table of GTK. Run it like this, CPP. But DXCOM, blah, blah, blah. I don't really know what this is about. Let's look up X11 compose file. Okay, so this is for a simple input method for characters beyond those represented on typical keyboards, using sequences of keystrokes that are combined to enter a single character. Okay, so this is kind of like key cording or whatever. All right, we'll ignore that. Here's CSS. It's not so large. We've got some enums. CSS location. What is the location? So we've got, I guess, like a location in the file. We've got some number of bytes, some characters, lines, line bytes, and line characters. That is a location. And they're all G sizes. So I don't know if these are like offsets or what. But somehow that's going to specify a location. We've got a CSS tokenizer, CSS serializer, and a in a CSS parser. And let's just take a look at the header. We're just importing stuff. All right, well, maybe enums are interesting. So these enums are things like, you know, did the parsing fail or succeed, et cetera. So this maybe is just for parsing. It doesn't seem, I don't know. It seems to be like trying to understand what is the CSS file saying rather than like applying CSS, perhaps. Okay, well, we will ignore that. Here's emoji. And it's a lot of .data files, which is not so surprising. We use emoji from Unicode and the CLDR stored in a G variant. I don't know what a G variant is, maybe something like an enum type. A G variant, a strongly typed value data type. It's a variant data type. It can contain one or more values along with information about the type of the values. I don't know that, but so what is a variant data type? I don't think I've heard of that. The variant data type is the data type for all variables that are not explicitly declared in some other data type, such as blah, 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 blah. Okay, semi-structured data types. Okay, so this is like, it seems kind of like soft typing where you're not actually representing types in the type system. You're kind of making your own ad hoc type system. So tell me about, I'll ask ChatGPT, tell me about variant data types. All right, so I'll assume that that's what's going on until ChatGPT tells me otherwise. Let's see if they have en.data, since that's the language I speak. Can I download this? Is it interesting to look at? Maybe it's not. Let's try opening it with, I don't know, Emacs. Okay, so we see some strings here and presumably some images. And these are, I guess, the like Unicode that would be rendered. Okay, so that's just what emojis are about. Roaring, what is roaring? Roaring bitmaps. This directory contains code modified for GTK based on roaring bitmaps, bitmaps reference implementation. So this is, again, some vendored code that they're using from some other repo that is some sort of bitmap implementation. Portable roaring bitmaps. Bitsets, also called bitmaps, are commonly used as fast data structures. Unfortunately, they can use too much memory. To compensate, we often use compressed bitmaps. Roaring bitmaps are compressed bitmaps, which tend to outperform conventional uncompressed bitmaps, such as WA, EWA, or concise. Okay, so a bitmap implementation that's somehow compressed. Compressed how? I'm not sure, but, you know, information theory. Okay, so here's GTK theme. We have an empty theme, which is nothing. So it's defined by some CSS file, as I suspected. And then in defaults, we have just a bunch of CSS. Default. This is the default theme. So let's just pick GTK dark. We're going to import URL, default dark.css. And was it SCSS? And we have, I guess it's like setting the variant to dark, setting the contrast to normal. Then we're importing colors, drawing, common, and colors public. So let's look at maybe colors. And we have like base color, text color, background color. And there should be some sort of switching on whether it's light or dark. So we have light is set to this color. If variant is light, then that. Otherwise, we're going to call darken this light color by 20%. This is SCSS. I think maybe it's like structured CSS. I forget really what that's about. SCSS, style sheet language, SAS. A preprocessor scripting language that is interpreted or compiled into cascading style sheets. Okay, so it's SAS. Okay, so it's something that's preprocessed into CSS. because I guess CSS is harder to work with. And we anytime something is declarative, people like to add layers of programmability to it. So here we are in UI. We're just kind of plowing along because, again, it's not clear what is the most interesting stuff. So in UI, we have a bunch of .ui files, and I'm going to guess that these are essentially XML files that are describing these different UI elements. So let's take a look at GTK video. Hey, it is XML. Okay, so So template class is GTK video. Its parent is GTK widget. So this is defining in XML the tree, like the widget tree. It may also be defined in source code. And the GTK video thing has a child. That child is what? As opposed to children, does it have multiple children? I think maybe this allows multiple children, but I guess maybe one child. Rather, the child is a single object, I guess, that which is of GTK overlay type. And that thing is a child, which has GTK graphics offload type, etc. So we've looked at Flutter and React. And in those systems, you kind of build up this XML tree in code. And I think that's a similar idea of Tailwind, is that you take something that used to be some like declarative file and move it into code. And this is kind of the older school way of doing it. You have some XML file that defines the relationships of the child and like what is this thing and what are its parent widgets, etc. So just trying to relate this to some of the stuff we've seen before. Let's take a look at something that's less complicated than video. Maybe GTK dialogue. We have a GTK dialogue which extends widget, and it's got a title bar. That's a type of child as opposed to a class. So the thing that's in its title bar is a GTK header bar with the ID header bar. And then we've got a GTK box, which presumably is going to contain like the error message or whatever this dialogue is about. And the box has some orientation, which is one. Presumably that's either vertical or horizontal. It's got some style. We're going to apply some CSS to it, which I guess the name of the CSS is dialogue VBox. I'm guessing one must be vertical, if that's V for vertical and VBox. And then we've got some other stuff like content area, etc. And then we've got some a GTK box, which has the ID action box with a styling GTK action box. And that has some action area, which I guess we're going to H expand and H align, horizontally expand, horizontally align. And that maybe is something you could put like buttons into. Okay, so that's what the UI elements are about. That's how you define a lot of the widget hierarchy, it looks like. Okay, so now we're in GTK, Excel group. I'm not really sure what an acceleration, I think this is Excel for acceleration, but I'm not really sure what it is. Accelerators. So we have modifiers. Maybe this is like modifier keys and stuff. Accelerator, accelerated keys. What? Doesn't seem to tell us much. So let's look up GTK accelerator. Is this just hotkeys? Installs an accelerator that will cause the named action to be activated when the key combination specified by accelerator is pressed. Yeah, I'm going to guess this is what we would call hotkeys. How to use accelerators in GTK. All right, so if this is basically hotkeys, what do we have? We can parse them. We can, I guess, know whether they're valid. We can parse with a key code. So what is the key code? So when we don't have a key code, we have a key and some mods. And when we do have a key code, we have a key and some codes and some mods. I'm not really sure what that's about, but we have a name for the accelerator. And we give it an accelerator key, I guess. And then we've got labels, etc. And I guess this is mainly just like registering, like parsing and validating and like somehow these will be registered, and then there will be some other system when you like press the keys for activating the accelerators. We have accelerator groups, which I'm going to guess are just groups of accelerators. GTK accelerator valid. Is this the C file now? No, this is just groups. Determines whether a given key value in modifier mask constitute a valid keyboard accelerator. For example, the GD key val plus GDK control mask mark is valid and matches the control plus A accelerator control A. But you can, for instance, use GDK K control L key val as an accelerator. I don't know why, but you can't. All right, accessible.h is the accessible interface. And what do we have? I guess we're declaring some interface. Not really sure what that does, but we've got some enum. GTK accessible platform state. Focusable, focused, or active. So I guess this is checking whether, you know, a GTK window has focus. And if you have something like a screen reader or a magnifier that might only apply to the window that has focus at any given time. And we have this accessible interface struct, which has a gtype interface, which I'm not really sure what that is. It seems pretty general. A GTK at context retrieves the platform specific accessibility context for the accessible implementation. So this is some pointer to, I guess, if there's some underlying accessibility mechanic to Windows or OS X or whatever, this is somehow a pointer to what the underlying thing is so that the accessibility layer of GTK can make use of it. We can get the platform state, checks if the given state applies to the accessible object. What is a platform state? I don't know. GTK access platform state. We can get the accessible parent of an accessible object. Okay, so this is somehow like walking up the tree of accessibility. We can get accessible siblings. I guess this is maybe like the, you know, all of the GTK elements may have some accessibility implementation, and somehow accessibility is maybe like an annotation on all of the nodes. So maybe we're doing something like moving around the tree, like with respect to examining accessibility or something along those lines. Or maybe accessibility itself forms some sort of tree that's independent of or alongside the window hierarchy. So we have set accessible parent, etc. Let's actually look up these one of these methods in the documentation. Set accessible parent. Sets the parent and sibling of an accessible object. This function is meant to be used by accessible implementations, which are not part of the widget hierarchy. So not part of the widget hierarchy, but act as a logical bridge between widgets. For example, if a widget creates an object that holds metadata for each child, and you want that object to implement the GTK accessible interface, you will use this function to ensure that the parent of each child widget is the metadata object, and the parent of each metadata object is the container widget. Okay. All right. I'm not sure exactly. I don't have a sense for how to envision that, but I mean, it's locally clear enough. There's some sort of hierarchy that you're using to build up accessibility tree. I don't know. It seems a bit clunky, but maybe that's just the way things are. Okay. Here's accessible value private. I thought maybe it would be useful to see some implementation of an accessible thing. So we've got some enum, undefined boolean, tri-state token, integer, maybe tri-state is like boolean plus maybe or undefined, token, integer, number, string, reference, or reference list. Um, Like, I don't know. Get GTK accessible value parse for relation. GTK int accessible value get. GTK autocomplete. I feel like this is like super, all of this seems like pretty confusing. GTK actionable. Let's ask Gemini. Tell me about how to use GTK's accessibility libraries. And we'll come back to it. Okay, so GTK actionable. Should be some sort of actionable thing. We're going to define a bunch of stuff. We have some actionable interface. We can get an action name, set an action name. And we've got a... whatever is going on here. I guess the G type, we're setting some types or whatever. And we've got some functions. No, I guess this is a function. It's a GTK actionable get type. You're going to pass in void. You're going to pass in a GNU C const thing, cast it as void, and get a G type back. We can get the action name. These are just like getters and setters. But like, what does it actually do? We've got some interface. So maybe I should know what a G type interface is. G type interface. An opaque structure uses the base of all interface types. Okay, it is pretty opaque. We've got this thing like adds prerequisite type to the prerequisites of the interface type, etc. You can peek at the parent. This is all a bit weird. I feel like we have lots of types and we're somehow using the type system, but it seems like we're, the types don't really give information about much of what's going on is the way that it seems to me, but maybe it's just because I'm disoriented. I don't think Gemini's telling me anything useful yet about accessibility. So I'll say, tell me about the GTK interface type. You're not being helpful here, Gemini. You're giving me just kind of like the most generic information. Let's see if ChatGPT is any better. No? What if I give it the actual name of the type here? Tell me about this specific type. It's the base type for defining interfaces in the GObject type system. It's a fundamental building block for defining functionality that multiple GObject-based classes can share. Think of it like a contract outlining a set of methods that conforming classes must implement. Okay, so this is an interface. This is meant to be, I guess, an interface type, like in other languages, but like wrapped up. But again, as opposed to using the interface, an interface system in the language itself, which I guess you could do in C++. I'm not sure. I think we're in straight C. I'm not sure how that would work in C. But again, it seems like we're kind of like barely, you know, we're implementing our own type system in C that's custom and doesn't necessarily have all of the nice features you would want of like a real programming language type system. It's just kind of the way it feels. You can't instantiate it. You can't directly instantiate the object. Inheritance. All interfaces in GTK inherit from this interface. It's typically defined by a structure, blah, blah, blah. Why not use a real interface like in Java? I think it's just because it's not supported in the language. Okay, so GObjects focus on types. GTK's underlying system, GObject, is heavily built on the concept of types. Is more about defining behavior, while G type interface acts as a blueprint for defining functionality within the G object type system. Okay, so this is really about G object type system. So, what Maybe let's take a quick look at the GObject type system. Type system context. Most modern programming languages come with their own native object systems and additional fundamental algorithmic language constructs, just as glib serves as an implementation of such fundamental types and algorithms, linked lists, etc. The glib object system provides the required implementations of a flexible, extensible, and intentionally easy to map into other languages object-oriented framework for C. Yeah, but it's not. But is GObject actually a type system in the way that C++ has a proper object-oriented type system? I think it would technically be another language, right? It's similar, but distinct from a full-fledged object-oriented type system. Inheritance, blah, blah, blah. C++ has stricter typing, multiple inheritance interfaces. Yeah, so I think this is just like a hacked, I'll call it hacked together type system that is, maybe it's super cool once you get into it, but I kind of feel like maybe this is a legacy that might be more confusing and hard than good. I think that's maybe why some people prefer Qt or Qt. At any rate, we have this GActionable thing. But anyway, so to me, the GObject stuff, not being familiar with it, makes all the code kind of hard to read. Even if you know C, you now have to reason about this type system that's not really implemented at the language level. It's like implemented like as a library. And so all of the syntax to me looks a little bit weird. I'm not sure what mechanisms they have for enforcing types, et cetera, et cetera. But let's plow along. Event controller is what? Okay, so GTK available and all, et cetera, et cetera. I'm not really sure. So like we're defining a bunch of methods. I guess this is the header. We've got some propagation limit. We've got getters and setters. And I'm not really sure what these kind of seem like maybe function types. So is event controller seems to be maybe a function. It's got some type instance check type. I guess maybe this is telling the type system to check something and making sure that it's of GTK type event controller. And let's ask Gemini what this, what does this define do in GTK code? I'm ready to explain the purpose. I need to paste it. Sorry, Gemini. I didn't mean to give you an impossible task. So GTK is event controller. Here's a breakdown. The macro checks if the object O is an instance of the GTK event controller. Okay, so this is just something you call on, you can call, I guess, in your file, which is essentially a poor man's type check. But I guess at runtime, right? So is this basically... Oh, I guess it runs on the preprocessor, right? A runtime type check? Or does it fail at compile time if the object is not of the appropriate type? This macro performs a compile time type check, not a runtime type check. Here's how. The provided macro uses blah, blah, blah. If there's a mismatch between the object's type and the controller, the compiler will raise an error during the compilation stage itself. The code won't even attempt to run the program. Will it really raise an error? I think it just returns a Boolean, right? Or I don't know. Okay, so I guess it depends on what this stuff means on the right hand side, and Gemini is saying that it does a compile time check. But let's look at the implementation. Gtype check instance. Checks if instance is an instance of the type defined by gtype. If instance is null, false will be returned. The macro should only be used in type implementations. Is not directly available to language bindings. Okay, so it's going to return null or false or true. So I think this is just some function that returns true or false. So I think this really is runtime reflection. But not sure. Gemini is telling me it's compile time. Okay, so we have GTK enums, and we're going to begin decals. And what do our enums look like? Align fill, align start, align center. So this is just alignment stuff. We have a bunch of arrow types, upright, left, down, BA start, etc. Baseline position, top, center, bottom. These are all, I guess, common things you would be familiar with if you've laid out stuff before, whether it's HTML or XML, as is the case with GTK. Content fit, fill, contain, cover, scale down. Okay, so this seems like a lot of different enums, like all of the things that you would use to position stuff. Type of list tabs. I don't know what list tabs are in this sense. Oh, this is like cycle through all focusable items on the list. So if you're like tabbing over things, like maybe if you're tabbing over windows, etc. Stuff on like scrolling and focusing, etc. Okay, so that's at least pretty sensible. Here's GTK expressions.c. GTK expression provides a way to describe references to values. Okay, so we've got some value and a reference to it, which is kind of like a pointer. We're going to somehow describe it, maybe by adding text. An important aspect of expressions is that the value can be obtained from a source that is several steps away. For example, an expression may describe the value of property A of object 1, which is itself the value of property of object 2, and object 1 may not even exist yet at the time the expression was created. This is in contrast to gobject property bindings, which can only create direct connections between the properties of two objects that must both exist for the duration of the binding. The expression needs to be evaluated to obtain the value that it currently refers to. Okay. Here's an example of a complex expression. So we're going to, I guess, call property extension new on a list item, whatever null is, but I guess passing in the string item. And we're going to get a color expression. And then we're going to set the type color to color expression and name. When evaluated with this being GTK list item, it will obtain the item property from the GTK list item, which, you know, might be some string or whatever is being listed in the list, and then obtain the name property from the resulting object, which is assumed to be of type GTK type color. So this is this again, to me, this seems like it's working around the absence of a real type system. So if you had some object, like in C++, and let's say you used inheritance, then you would peek inside the list and get its item. And what is it doing? Is it getting the color or setting the color? Obtain the name. Wait, where is it using color? Okay, which is assumed to be of type GTK color. Okay, so you would just call like list at like 4 or whatever, or like list indexed with the key item, and then call dot name on it or whatever, right? But because we don't have a real type system, we've got this kind of like crazy thing. We're like implementing language features, kind of to work around stuff is kind of what this looks like to me. And I'm not going to go too far down this rabbit hole, but we will plow along. But we have things like an expression has a type, which is a G type. We can ref and unref them. We can check whether they're static. We can try to evaluate them, etc. Okay, here's GTK file chooser dialog. And this is the C file. I think that maybe we didn't have a header, or maybe I looked at it separately. Let's see if there's a header. It doesn't like that. Okay. GTK file chooser dialog is a dialog suitable for use with file open or file save commands. Yeah. This widget works by putting a file chooser widget inside a dialog. Okay, so file chooser widget is separate. It exposes the file chooser interface so you can use all of the file chooser functions on the file chooser dialog as well as those for dialog. So it's just some composition of a chooser and a dialog, but I'm gonna guess it's much more complicated than in other languages where you could just compose the two things. Like in Flutter, it seems like you would just have like a dialog on the outside, and then inside would be a child file chooser. But this seems to be going through a bunch of rigmarole, again, possibly because of the fact that they've kind of implemented this type system as a library as opposed to being like kind of inherent to the language. GTK label, I'm going to guess it's just a label. I'm going to just kind of ignore it. Header, list item. Maybe list item is interesting. List item should be small. So you've got an enum with an accessible description and an accessible label. Whether it can be activated, child, I don't know if this is whether you are a child or whether you have a child, or like a pointer to your child or something. Whether it's focusable, an item, maybe it's the item that's being held in the list, its position, and whether it's selectable, etc. And then this is dispose, this is get property. So you're going to pass in an object and a property ID. And get a value and some other stuff, or rather pass in a value and some pspec. It's void. So I guess maybe the value is the out parameter, and I'm not sure what param spec is. But we're going to call GTK list item on the object. And I guess that's going to maybe like cast the raw object into a list. If this were a real type system, I guess you just pass the list in and the function would know that it was a list. And then we're going to switch on the property ID. And again, if this were just like object-oriented programming, you would just do dot property or ID or whatever. But we're going to do a switch statement on this like integer and check for this enum. And we'll find that one of them is... Oh, okay. So for each of the enum, we just do a thing. So like if it's a, let's say the child, we're going to call g value set object self child on the g value, which I think is the return value. Okay. So that's kind of just a flavor of how some of this stuff works. Here's GTK main. It's really small. But we just, oh, well, this is the header, but maybe the C file's large, but we're going to do things like init. Check that if it's init, check if it's initialized, etc. Do an ABI check, and so on and so forth. It's pretty simple. Here's the C. Is it huge? It is huge. Maybe I'll just look at init. What is it, GTK init? GTK init check. It does the same okay, so how about void? Somewhere. Not sure. So we do keep like a boolean of whether it's initialized. This does the same work as GTK init with only a single change. It does not terminate the program if the windowing system can't be initialized. Instead, it returns false on failure. So init check, we're going to have this boolean return value. If it's initialized, we return true. We check if a profile is running, profiler is running. We call it get text initialization. So something about initializing get text. check the set UI, set UGID, do some parsing, etc. Look at the display, which I guess is going to under the hood call X11 or Windows or whatever, and maybe do some debugging stuff and then return. Okay, that's relatively simple. Range we're going to ignore, and the implementation of range we're going to ignore. And that's that'll be GTK for me. So that was a little bit hard. I feel like we got a good sense of what it's like to work in GTK, what it's like to extend it. Personally, to me, it seems like a lot of cognitive overhead to kind of, you have to really embed yourself in the GTK way of doing things. And I feel like it might be an interesting project to try to rewrite some of it in like C++ or Rust, kind of reifying the type system in a real type system, but trying to reuse as much of the look and feel as possible, the same algorithms, the same kinds of widgets, maybe consume the same XML files. And then that might make it like a more natural thing to work in. So that's all for me. I'll be back tomorrow for some more streams. Thanks for watching.